Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord and servant of the Lord.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God, Almighty God.
Lives and reigns with you in this Trinity, one Glory to the Father, and to the Son,
and to the Holy Spirit, and as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
A reading from Isaiah chapter 55, starting at verse 1. Come, all you who are thirsty, come to the waters. And you who have no money, come, buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk, without money and without cost. Why spend money on what is not bread, and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen, listen to me and eat what is good, and you will delight in the riches of fare. Give ear and come to me. Listen, that you may live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you, my faithful love promised to David. See, I have made him a witness to the peoples, a ruler and commander of the peoples. Surely you will summon nations you know not, and nations you do not know will come running to you, because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel. For he has endowed you with splendor. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways, and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and he will have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
The second reading is from Corinthians chapter 10, reading from verse 1. For I do not want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud and that they all passed through the sea. They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. They all ate the same spiritual food and drank the same spiritual drink. For they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was pleased with most of them, their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. Now these things occurred as examples to keep us from setting our hearts on evil things as they did. Do not be idolaters, as some of them were. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink, and got up to indulge in revelry. We should not commit sexual immorality, as some of them did, and in one day 23,000 of them died. We should not test Christ, as some of us did, and we were killed by snakes. And do not grumble, as some of them did, and were killed by the destroying angel. These things happened to them as examples and were written down as warnings for us, on whom the culmination of all ages has come. So, if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. No temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. And God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so you can endure it. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Listen to the good news proclaimed in the gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 13, beginning at the first verse.
Glory to Christ, our Savior.
Now there was some present at that time who told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mixed with their sacrifices. Jesus answered, "Do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered this way? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will all perish." Or those 18 who died at the Tower of Siloam fell on them. Do you think they were more guilty than all the others living in Jerusalem? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will all perish. Then he told this parable. The man had a fig tree growing in his vineyard, and he went to look for fruit on it, but did not find any. So he said to the man who took care of the vineyard, "For 3 years now, I have been coming to look for fruit on this fig tree, and haven't found any. Cut it down. Why should it use up the soil?" "Sir," the man replied, "leave it alone for one more year, and I'll dig around it and fertilize it. If it bears fruit next year, fine. If not, we'll cut it down." This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to Christ, our Lord.
So calamity. Tomorrow we commemorate the 21st of March as Human Rights Day, in memory of another calamity that happened in this country, the Sharpeville massacre. Indeed, others massacred on that same day in other parts of our country, but none as many as those found in Sharpeville. 69 people killed by gunshots in the back. Evidence that they meant no harm, that they were running away and still struck down. How is God in control in the midst of all of this calamity? What does it mean for us to worship a God who is powerful? And we look at our newspapers and we watch the scenes on our television screens, and in some ways there's just no place to put that. The Tetris is broken. Things don't fit. So our gospel reading in verse 1 of chapter 13 in Luke's account, we see two stories, two incidences being brought to Jesus, because again, the Tetris is not working. Sorry, Tetris is a game of blocks where everything must fit into each other and form neat rows. The puzzle pieces don't fit. And so they come to Jesus and they say there were these Galileans who were offering sacrifices. And Pilate, a violent political leader, mixed their blood with the blood of their sacrifice. What, Jesus, are we to make of this story? The second, again, people coming to offer sacrifices. So maybe just to take a step back and say, this practice of offering sacrifice very often used to be a way of trying to make sure that you're in the good books, that God is pleased with you. You come and you offer sacrifices to make sure things are clean on your end. And the exchange then is that God then makes sure that everything remains ayoba, right? Isn't that how it works? Lord, I came to church. I sang songs of worship. So we're good, right? In both of these accounts, the words of Jesus are repeated. But unless you repent, you will all perish. Verse 3, and then again verse 5. No, but unless you repent, you will all perish just as they did. And then Jesus goes on to tell a parable to try and explain what these words are supposed to mean. Come back to my original question, what do we make of calamity? Who is to blame for the calamity that we find in the world and in our lives? A man had a fig tree that he planted in his vineyard, and he came and said to the gardener, this fig tree is not producing any fruit. Three years. It's like an oxygen thief, taking up soil in my garden. Let's cut it down. This parable is not to be confused with the story of Jesus cursing the fig tree. You remember that one? This is a parable, so this didn't really happen. This story is illustrating what Jesus is trying to teach. The person in this parable, the man who plants the fig tree, is not God. The person who tends the fig tree, that's God. Jesus, in this instance, the gardener, who advocates on behalf of this fruitless tree, saying, have mercy, just one more year. Just We don't know what the answer is. That's for next week's reading. But in the account that we are given in the story, I want to bring together this idea of who's responsible or to blame for calamity, what we need to repent of, and what does fruitfulness mean. Who is to blame for calamity? Any ideas? Whose fault is it that the Ukrainians are suffering right now? Whose fault is it that there's a war in Ethiopia at the moment? Whose fault is it that someone is mourning the death of a son, a brother, a friend? Who's responsible for what happened at Sharpeville? Is that Mangaliso Robert Sobukwe? Or the police officer who gave the first instruction to shoot? Who is responsible for the perils you and I face in our day-to-day life? And how does repentance really help us when we find ourselves in calamity? You see, when we find ourselves in calamity and we think this is not supposed to be happening to me, have you had that feeling? Why is this happening to me? I'm so good, Lord. I thought we were tight. What that speaks to is dysfunction in our relationship with God. You see, there's no amount of sacrifice. No amount of sacrifice. There's no amount of sacrifice that is needed for you to be more tight with God. We heard Jesus did that for us. And so when there is calamity and we're asking the question, but why me, Lord? In this question comes the invitation for repentance. Why not you? Why should it be someone else? How is it that you think that the disciples of Jesus could be slaughtered and crucified and rolled in tar and used as streetlights, and somehow we are exempt from suffering? There is good news. But when we understand the world to be a place where I get to have my way because I believe in Jesus, then those ideas are ideas that you and I need to repent of. Can I say that again? If we think that the only reason God exists is to make sure that my life is okay, then God must die. So that we make room for the living God. Who cares about everyone's struggle? Who cares about everyone's pain? Who never promises exemption from suffering, promises the very presence of God in the midst of pain. And so in this Lenten journey, how do we journey deeper into this invitation to repentance? So that repentance can produce fruit just like this fig tree. I don't know what that looks like for you. Is there a place where you feel like you're lacking and you need something from God and you find yourself bargaining? Lord, if, then? Can you think of a story like that right now? Can you think of a story, perhaps when you've asked God, but seriously, Lord, why me? I'm not saying don't ask the question, but let that not be the only question. Not only why me, but how else can I? How else can I live through this difficulty with integrity? How else can I live through the struggle without the struggle defining me, but your words shaping me at the same time? How, Lord? How can I deal with calamity in such a way that my picture of you becomes bigger and is not reduced only to what is happening to me right now? How do I make sense of the evil that I see? When you seem to say nothing, you see all of these things that we name calamities hit up against this ideas that we have of God. When I was a young child, I had a very active prayer life. I prayed about many things. I was 4 years old when I first gave my heart to Jesus. And there were so many things I prayed about, and it was amazing. Things just happened. Things that I prayed for would happen. I can't explain it. And then at age 12, my dad got cancer. I thought, that's not a problem. I can just pray. And when my father died of cancer at age 12, my faith hit a crisis. This God who was always answering my prayers suddenly was gone. Impotent. Silent. You see, it is in this moment that we find ourselves not only in calamity, but with an opportunity to redraw our picture of who God is. For our small Father Christmas picture of God to die, because it must. And for us to journey deeper into, so who is this God who hasn't healed my father but still wants to be my friend while I grieve and become father to me as I enter my teenage years? Do you see this journey? If God had to remain Father Christmas for me, then that relationship would have ended there and then. It would be over. Because it's of no value to me anymore. But for each of us, as we face calamity, we face this opportunity, in Trevor Hudson's words, to redraw our picture of who God is. To discover that, yes, God does answer prayer, but God also helps me to grieve. God is also a God of comfort. God is also one who can provide me with many fathers over the years, who have stood proxy, who have held my hands, who has asked me difficult questions that I didn't want to answer, who have acted in ways that my father would have as I've grown up. Who is this God? Who are you who says, and lo, I am with you always, 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 even to the end? to meet with this God in this Lenten season, all of us need a deeper repentance. A deeper repentance that says, Lord, forgive me for making you so small. Forgive me for reducing you to the words, God's got this. Because you know what? We can't say that to anyone in the Ukraine right now. If it's God's will, it's God's will. No. It's not going to work. It is a betrayal to someone who is holding their dead child in their arms because a bomb has fallen on their home. We can't. We have to do the hard work of admitting that our picture of God is too small. It doesn't matter who we are and how long you've worshipped God and how long you've been part of St. Philip's or how long you've been an Anglican. All of us, our picture of God is too small. This Lenten season invites us into repentance. To repent of the smallness that we hold God in. And a deeper journey into discovering the bigness of who God is. Who is able to be present and merciful like this gardener was to the fig tree. Merciful to create conditions for each of us to bear the fruit that is in keeping with the Holy Spirit. So that we, like in the words of the prophet Isaiah, can respond to that invitation, come. Come those who have no money, those who have no food, come. Come. Come close. Come be in community. Come be in fellowship. Come be together. There's no one person who can live this calamitous life on our own. We are given the gift of one another. So that together we can make sense what's happening in the world and reflect to one another our pictures of who God is so that we can grow. And so a final image that is really a question. What is your picture of God? What is your picture of God this morning? How might that picture lead us into repentance? For that very image, to say, yes, God, I have this beautiful picture of who you are, but I realize that you are so much more. So help me grow my picture of you. So that we together can continue to sing, you're all that I want, you're all that I've ever needed. Help me know you are me. Amen.
Keeping us from becoming who you want us to be. as individuals and as a community. Lord, we pray for the people of Ukraine, of Yemen, of Ethiopia, of Syria, of Myanmar, of all of these countries that are either at war or have been invaded. And we pray for the refugees in our own country, on our own doorsteps. We repent of the money that we waste on things that don't provide nourishment. Help us to spend our money where it does provide nourishment. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you have taught us to pray and to give thanks for all. Receive our prayers for the universal church, that it may know the power of your Spirit, and that all your children may agree in the truth of your holy word, and live in unity and godly love. We pray for your servant, Joshua, our bishop, together with Tabor, our metropolitan, and for all other ministers of your word and sacraments, that by their life and teaching, your glory may be revealed, and all nations draw to you. Guide and prosper, we pray, those who strive for the spread of your gospel, and enlighten with your Spirit all places of work, learning, and healing. We pray for those who have authority and responsibility among the nations, that ruling with wisdom and justice, they may promote peace and well-being in the world. To this congregation, and to all your people in their different callings, give your heavenly grace, that we may hear your holy word with reverent and obedient hearts, and serve you truly all the days of our life. In your compassion, Father and Mother, comfort and heal those who are in trouble, sorrow, need, or sickness. We praise and thank you for all your saints, for the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of Jesus Christ our Lord, and for the heroes of the faith, every generation, and we remember before you your servants who have died, praying that we may enter with them into the fullness of your unending joy. Grant this, Holy Father, for Jesus Christ's sake.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh,
you, Lord God of all creation, through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made.
Blessed it becomes the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands.
Blessed it becomes the cup of salvation. Blessed be God forever.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let's give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, it is our duty and our joy at all times and in all places to give you thanks and praise, Holy Creator, Heavenly Ruler, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, our Saviour and Lord.
Holy indeed are you, O God. And holy is your eternal word, your living wisdom, the firstborn of all creation, who, for us and for our salvation, took flesh from the womb of Mary, was born and lived among us.
Being found in human form, he humbled himself, even to death on the cross.
Father, Lord, and 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 Lord, and
Christ in your hearts, by faith with thanksgiving.
Behold who we are,
and we become what we receive.
Daughter, Father God, of her, I pray that you will give her the strength, Father God, patience, persons. And I pray, Father, your blessing upon her. So, Father God, I pray that also as she celebrates her birthday, she would stand, Father, I pray that you will bless her. Guard her, surround her with your peace and with your love. So, Father God, I want to give you thanks, Lord, for Adrian and
Renee.
As they celebrate their birth, rest, a week, and this year, Father God, Lord, I pray that they will continue to build their home, Lord, on 1 Corinthians 13, Lord, the foundation. Father, be with them. I thank you, Father God, for the 2 years that they've been together. Thanks, Father God, that you hold them. And as the journey, Father God, will continue to be with them, Lord, as they grow closer to each other. Father God, pray all these prayers to your name, Amen. I just want to ask Renee, thank you, remember your week. It was a peace. I was trying to let you what you say on that day, but he's with me. Will you please stand?
Notices.
Oh,
notices.
Oh, notices.
We must
stand for notices. Right. Do you have a spot, right? So, for Holy Week, there's actually a number of services. Just to be aware, we start off with Palm Sunday on the 10th of April. Then we're doing a Stations of the Cross on the Wednesday, the 13th of April. So we won't have a Bible study that night, we will have Stations of the Cross. Morning Thursday will be a service. We won't be washing our feet because of COVID restrictions, but we will have a service which properly commemorates the Last Supper. Leading to Good Friday, we will have a service which will be in 3 parts from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. And Easter, we've got the 2 services, the 6 o'clock service in the morning, the candlelight vigil, and then the 9 o'clock service, which will also be a baptism service. And hope that you can make most of it come all of those services. And then on Wednesday night, we will be having our evening prayer and Bible study this coming week at 7 o'clock as well. Thank you.
And so, dear friends, for so many things to love and serve
the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.
It's not a notice, but last week we put out the call and we asked anyone who's interested in joining the worship team to come up and join. And I don't know if you see, we have quite a nice full band here this morning. So we just want to thank our new members. You can join us here. We can you can get a tambourine to shake. You can get a jumper for you to drum, or you can stand here and just worship. You're more than welcome.
And just to say, I don't know who the youngest member of your band is. What her name is?
Juliet.
Juliet came up for communion this morning, and I gave her the wafer, and then she looked at me. And she said, "I want a blessing."